morning. No. Good morning, everybody. Everybody is not in church, but maybe if we start, they'll come. So welcome to our service this morning, and we're going to begin by singing the praise song, Hosanna. So please stand.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna in the highest. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Grace and peace to you from God.
God with
the Lord be with you.
The Lord you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
We have no Michael.
We have no Michael, so John's
going to
pray now.
Okay.
Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for our time together. Thank you for sunny days, for summer, for sleep, for goodness, but thank you more for the privilege of worshiping you in your house. We come to you with hearts open, with eyes open, and with expectant and joyful hearts. We thank you for who you are, and we ask you to be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a seat for a second. There are no good stories from Michael this morning. He was going to tell you the story about his flight to Wellington. But I have a good story. So I baptized an incredibly cute 2-year-old called Grace Hadley a couple of weeks ago. And she wanted to be baptized in the chapel of College House. So she had been practicing in the bath to do her baptism. And I've learned the hard way that you've got to skip the water over the head and then say the baptism words really fast before the screaming happens. And so I went, I baptize you, Grace, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And she just gave this really cute smile. I went, and I thought, God is with me, this is good. And then we got to the baptism candle, and we lit the candle, and we said, shine with the light of Christ. And she received the candle, she blew it out, and she started singing Happy Birthday. So my homily was all about how baptism is basically like having a new birthday, and that you get a church birthday as well as an ordinary birthday, just like the Queen does. And I hope that I desperately hope that doesn't happen to me ever again. But it was a beautiful moment. It reminded me of the grace and the newness of baptism. And I thought I'd share it with you while we're waiting for the vicar. Has anyone else got any good stories that would bless anyone to hear? Anything brilliant happen over the summer? Yes, in the back, Mr. Brantley.
Apologies for being late this first This Friday till yesterday evening, for about 28 hours, I flew up to Wellington for my father-in-law's 80th birthday. He's been a part of their Salvation Army Corps parish since, he'll tell you, the 16th of January of 1956. He'd been there a day or two. Sitting next to him is, you have all these important people for his birthday yesterday, and warm and outside and lovely, was a lady named Gladys, who they have known since that time. She did not think she would live to see his 80th. She had done some teaching and forming of him, and later was Suzanne's Sunday school teacher. And here she was, the legacy of impacting multiple generations of this family. And just the and she told me that, and she had told me before, but it's been a number of years, that when we send out our little newsletters and such, she prays for us every day. She pulls out the letter and prays for us and prays for the people that we bring to mind and the ministry in the church here. And so it was just so lovely to be encouraged by this saint who doesn't do ministry anymore, but here she is impacting lives and praying, and she gets to see the legacy that she did yesterday. It was great.
Okay. Anyone else? Going, going, gone. Let's stand for the peace. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
And to far now, to karate, we are the body of Christ.
Spirit, we're baptized into one body.
Keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace.
Amen. We are bound by the love of Christ.
Red stranger, sign of peace. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Be seated. As a community of faith, we continue to worship God as we pray together. Let us pray. Hear God's word to all who turn to Christ. Happy are those whose sins are forgiven, whose wrongs are pardoned. I will confess my sins to the Lord. I will not conceal my wrongdoings. And let us just keep a moment silence while we think of the things that we haven't done so well over this last week. God forgives and heals us. We need your healing, merciful God. give us true repentance. Some sins are plain to us. Some escape us. Some we cannot face. Forgive us. Set us free to hear your word to us. Set us free to serve you.
In Jesus Christ, we have a lawyer at the judgment. Through the cross of Christ, God have mercy on you, pardon you, and set you free. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. God strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal. Amen.
Of Christ, rule in our hearts. The word of Christ dwell in us richly. And the thought for today, I greatly delight in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness. And together we say the collect. Spirit of the Lord God, you bring good news to the oppressed. Bind up the brokenhearted. Proclaim liberty to the captives and release the prisoners. You comfort all who mourn and shower your people with the oil of gladness instead of mourning, a mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. We will greatly rejoice in the Lord for the sake of the one who brought righteousness to life, Jesus Christ, our salvation. Amen.
Please turn to page 587 in your pew Bible. A reading from Isaiah chapter 44, beginning at verse 1. But now hear, O Jacob my servant, Israel whom I have chosen. Thus says the Lord who made you, who formed you in the womb and will help you. Do not fear, O Jacob my servant, Jushim whom I have chosen. For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon your descendants and my blessing on your offspring. They shall spring up like a green tismic, like willows by flowing streams. This one will say, I am the Lord's. Another will be called by the name of Jacob. Yet another will write on the hand, the Lord's, and adopt the name of Israel. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel reading.
Please turn to page 785 in your pew Bible. Today's gospel reading is from St. Matthew chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the gospel of Christ.
And let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Loving God, speak to us in a tangible way, maybe a way that's surprising, maybe a way that we feel we need to hear and sense your presence and your speaking in our life. Speak to us individually. Speak to the doubter and the cynic. Speak to the one on their last strand of faith. Speak to the one who is passionate and excited and new. Speak to the guests. Speak to the member here the longest. Speak to your church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's good. Please, yeah, you guys know the routine. Come on. It is good to be back. Confession time, I probably could have used 2 more weeks. I don't know if that's age or just fatigue or I like playing. But it is good to be back and to see everyone, hence me being late into the service because I was in the other morning tea. I got in that first service, and I expected more to be gone because it's summer and families and trips, and thing was crowded as. And I knew this would be the service that had the most still on holiday, and it did not disappoint. But it's good to be back with everyone. I came in here this week several times, but also in my mind, sitting in that chair, looking out, because you all sit in the same places every time. And in my mind, worked the room and prayed for you. And I took and worked through the directory and prayed for you. So I hope it has been a blessed time, particularly after these difficult few years. Look, this week, we begin 9 weeks of the same gospel reading every week. So just get prepared. It's not too long. It's because we're going to spend 9 weeks in the Beatitudes. And today I want to do 2 things. One, kind of overview, what are they? And second, dig into the first one, which you make the first one for a reason. And if you can get your arms around this passage, this is the passage that Jesus really goes public with his ministry and who he is. And he begins this seminal Sermon on the Mount with these verses of these Beatitudes. The blesseds are. And when I look at the list, I look at the list and go, yeah, you can give me some of that, and I'll take a double heap of that, and I'll take a tasting of that one. No, I don't really know if I want that one. But they are something that are supposed to be important. And all of us, even if we don't have them memorized, as others say it, we can usually say it along with them. And if somebody says the blessed are thee, we quite often can finish the back half. It's like the lullaby that you heard for years, and when you hear it today, it still has a resonance with you. But you don't stop and think about it. It's there. I was riding in the car with Jack, and Jack was in charge of music that day, and he pulled up the Blind Alabama Boys. I don't know if you've heard of them. Group of black fellows who sing mostly a cappella, not completely, and they sing spiritual songs, some of them older, some of them newer, and they did Amazing Grace, but using House of the Rising Sun. And when you have grown up in New Orleans, if you know the lyrics of that song, it makes sense why that song goes there for me. It just has that memory. But I don't stop and think about the words. We ended up singing it as you drive along, as you do. And we're singing the words to Amazing Grace, but we're going to this tune, and worlds were colliding, but I wasn't sitting there thinking about what either meant. They were just comforting. And when we hear these, they tend to have that meeting. But let's be honest, even if we thought about it, even if we read it, even if we know it's a seminal opening to Jesus' biggest opus that goes public with who he is to the world, we don't stop and think, really, what does that stuff mean? And he does a little playing in language in the Aramaic, in the Greek, in the Latin, in the English, that kind of leaves us, what does he mean by that? But this is seminal for who God's people are supposed to be. So we're going to invest some time in it. Because most of us actually probably would feel not ready for a test on the passage. When you come to societies, there are people that we acknowledge for their contributions. There are people who, particularly in the Commonwealth, we have a good system of recognizing these people. Queen's Medal, King's Medal, and different ranks and acknowledgments of their contributions across a multiplicity of fields and specializations. They're marked to say, these are people that we acknowledge their contribution and are people we emulate and strive to be like. Now, they're not bad, but they can be kingdom-oriented or not kingdom-oriented. I look at some of the lists and go, seriously? And I look at some of the lists and go, you're right, yep. But in the kingdom's honors list, it's upside down from the world. There was a fellow. His name was Yeshua, Joshua, Jesus, same name. And Yeshua, son of Sirach, was a poet. He lived about 200 years prior to Jesus. And he wrote a poem to kind of communicate, hey, society, let's acknowledge the kind of people we celebrate because it kind of tells us what our values and our mores are. These are the things that kind of define us. Now, I'm going to not try to say the poem because it doesn't translate to English well. And it would need constant, well, here's what he means by this. It'd need all of that. So, but I'm going to give you his list, but I'm going to use modern people on photograph to show you that this is a human thing and we're no different. So Jesus, son of Sirach's list began with acknowledging good rulers who make a difference, who remind us who we're supposed to be and where we are going. Wise counselors, highly sought after in his post-career for the wisdom he might give people in society, not just men, but men tend to resonate with him, and the things he has to say are good. Leaders that think ahead, that tell us what we can expect next. We don't always agree with them, but they are the ones thinking bigger than today. Musical composers who communicate what's in us and sometimes use words. John and I met, the top right there is Yo-Yo Ma, born in China but been in the States for a long time, doesn't even have an accent anymore, Chinese. And John and I met at his concert because Bryden, if people have been here and remember Bryden, he ambushed us and gave us tickets sitting next to each other and did not tell us that. But a great affair began that day. Poets who interpret what society feels or needs to hear and challenges us. Jesus, son of Sirach, looked at people who are masters in their field and help society prosper and move. He also acknowledged important military leaders. I hope you recognize the one on the top right. SAS New Zealand, highly respected across SAS and U.S. Special Forces. Bottom right, does anybody know who he is? New Zealand General. Yep, say it louder. Yep, who orchestrated very meager resources to actually win the Battle of Britain. Colin Powell, and then top left, Schwarzkopf. Centaurs who are the stability in the society. people who speak and remind us and call us back. Jesus, son of Sirach, acknowledged people in philosophy and science and medicine who make a real difference. And I know it's rare in New Zealand, but back then they celebrated athletes and acknowledged their contributions to society. Now, none of these lists are bad. They're all good. But that doesn't mean they're Jesus, because imagine if you're one of these people and you're a Jesus person. It's just an amplification. But when you're a Jesus person and you're not one of these famous people, there's something about the Jesus person in that list which launches Jesus saying, this is what the kingdom is like, salt and light and solid foundations versus sand. But he starts with these nine blesseds. So I ask the question to try to get the import of this. We have to start with blessed or blessed. The Baptists say blessed, the Anglicans say blessed. What does it even mean to be blessed? And we all have an idea, and we could probably fill a whiteboard. But I went back and just did some original scriptural work in multiple languages and felt more confused at the end. No, seriously. It's going to be hard to grasp what blessing means, but it basically is pronounced favor in reality. That probably shocks you. It's the gifts, remember that word in a moment, that bring shalom. Now, we translate shalom, the word peace, but that's incomplete. It's the gifts and the favor and the reality of wholeness and completeness and soundness and peace and rightness. We would say righteousness. So Jesus starts with this list of these people who have God's favor. But what they're not is they are not a religious rite, do this so God's happy with you. They are not religious demand so that you perform well and dead. They are is that we would consider this is who we're supposed to be. And like if we were to hold a large diamond, as you twist it, the light turns and moves. And one gaze of the light moving through it is incomplete. You need to turn it to get more of the impact of that diamond. So I'm going to give you three motifs that maybe you'll connect with one of them. The first is the Beatitudes are the beautiful attitudes. This is who you are. I am using the Bible in 1 year organized by Nikki Gumbel. I am an auditory learner, an auditory reflector. John reads hours on end. I had the goal in my stack of 37 to-read books to at least do 4 during this time away. I read 0. 2 pages, I have 1 chapter. But I did the Bible in 1 year every day from January the 1st so far, and I get to listen to it. And you get each passage in Nikki, decades of phenomenal, exceptional leadership, is able to catalyze it, and I'm just like, whew. Now, look, here's the deal. In whatever your field is, you probably, if you ever see anybody else doing what you do, you probably sit there and you're doing scorecards without ever saying so, right? We do. I do. When I go to another church, I sit there and give them scorecards. Peter gives me a scorecard at the end of each Sunday now. When I listen to Nikki, I don't keep scorecards. And I let him speak to me. And the thing that comes out from Nikki that I love, whether he's saying the easiest thing or the hardest thing, is the beautiful attitude and perspective and posture he has. So Jesus says, to be Jesus' people, let's just get this sorted first before we dig into the details. These are the beautiful attitudes that come out of people who are mine, who've walked up close and been with me. And just this morning, listening to Bible in 1 year, as I'm preparing my coffee at like 6 in the morning, having already had the dogs out, is Nikki talking about this very thing. And he reminds us of the verse where Jesus says, it's not what goes in the body that defiles the body, it's what comes out. Because it's what's already in the heart. And if you want to be Jesus' people, and you want a life that's different from the world, then you pursue him. And what does that look like? To be real honest, Everybody in our world wants a pragmatic list, a program, some steps. And I get it. I get why. I like it defined down like that. It's the product of having been in the presence of God. It's what happens when you spend time with Him. And quite often when you talk to these saints that are so transformed, when you meet them, you just know they're different. Gladys, who I mentioned a while ago, decades of being a saint pursuing Jesus, you just bend down and talk to her with her face, which is so pruned, and the Shekinah glory comes off of her. If you go to Exodus 33, you see the tent of meeting, the tabernacle, is set up outside the camp. And the Hebrews were a big group of people. And when Moses would head out there, everybody would stand at the door of their tent, and Moses would go in. And then the pillar of God, that cloud, would move to the front of that tent, and everybody would bow down on the ground. After the whole tablet thing, they were, yeah, quite respectful of God. But the next verse tells us that Moses would meet with God in the tent, face to face, as one friend with another. And that's where all the spiritual lessons stop and Moses comes out, right? But if you read the next verse, Moses would depart, but his young assistant, who was a teenager then, a guy named Joshua, would remain. And until that said, you don't even know that Joshua's in there. But the whole time, Joshua's in the presence of God with somebody who knows God face to face like a friend, and then God would leave and Joshua would stay. I cannot wait till I get to heaven. Top 10 question list. Joshua, what happened in the tent when Moses left? Please tell me. And Joshua's contribution would have earned him a KBE for his leadership of those people, as you know. When you have the beautiful attitudes, it's like fruit on a tree. I have a baby grapefruit tree that replaced the non-performing apricot tree. In my garden, if you're a rose bush and you don't make roses, you're gone. If you're a fruit tree and you don't make fruit, you're gone. I'm quite utilitarian and harsh. I nursed it for 3 years, it didn't work, and went the grapefruit. The grapefruit is in its second year, and it's, of course, if anybody, you're in Christchurch, you know these things, the first 3 years, you don't let it have any fruit. I'm probably going to let it have one. But it's got like 50 little grapefruits growing on it. I didn't make the fruit. All I did is husband the plant. I made sure it's got good soil and right nutrition and water and not enough water and not too dry. And when winter came, it had a frost cloth that lived over it so sunlight could get through the whole winter. But on the cold nights, and the young adults can testify because they'd show up on a Monday and it's dark or getting dark, and I'm out there with a black rubbish bag putting it over it and clipping it to the little poles to protect my baby. All I did is care for it, do the right things, and fruit is produced. But there's something about fruit. Fruit is never for the plant that produces it. Fruit benefits others. Fruit is the gift to everyone else. So if you develop these beautiful attitudes, you become a gift to everybody else. We have a society that runs around protecting itself, afraid of vulnerability, afraid of bonding because it's had so much betrayal. But when you come to God's people, you know when God's moving because they're sharing their fruit with everyone else and they care for everyone else, even when they mess it up, even when they're on their last straw. Imagine a church, you wouldn't know it this morning, but across our church, there's 500 plus active people in this parish. Imagine 500 people loving each other radically. You'd be like, God, stop, it's too much. It's too much blessing, too much love. Imagine 500 people infecting Avonhead and Islam and this end of Riccarton and Yaldhurst and Rustley. If the whole church together had these beatitudes. It's who they are. Takeaway, litmus test. Not how much you look like this today, but over time, how's it changing and moving and transforming? You want to be this person? Here is the one-step secret program. It is the opening of your will to allow God to, you're not going to like this word in Western society, conform you to God's image. You have to will it and not grit your teeth. He's not going to force it because it's a relationship, not a bow the knee or I'll slap you on the head. Second metaphor, the Beatitudes are a map. For me to drive home, for me to drive to Matt's work out of the city to the southwest, I don't use a map. I turn with landmarks. I know the road. I know the buildings. When I go to the Hollis's household, I know when to turn by this big, neatly trimmed, 3-meter-tall hedge. That's where I turn left. Hey. And that's how I know. That's why I don't need Google Maps to go there. There are these markers that you recognize, that you know you're on the right path. When I fly in from Great Britain or North America, or you know, if you go to Australia, you'd fly into Christchurch. You know when you're getting close to home because it goes from that gray-blue to all of a sudden there's green. And we have quite noted topography no matter which international airport you fly into. And you notice it as you get closer because even the markers of the city start to be recognizable. Friday, we had this beautiful day in Wellington and in Christchurch and a very smooth flight until we were like 500 feet off the strait, and he's lining the plane up to land in Wellington. Do you know they have to have special certification to fly in and out of there? And we're on one of those two across each row, right? The propeller commuters. And I'm on about 2/3 back, and I'm looking down the runway. And then I'm looking out at the strait. But as the pilot pulls it straight, all of a sudden I see that wonky tower, and I look over there because I've flown it so many times, and I know where to look. I can see my in-law's place. You know when it's home. When we take the dogs, which we like to do, to someplace like Sumner to the beach, the little boy, Fido, whines the whole way there. But he gets there and he interacts with people and other dogs and the ocean and running around, and he gets back in the car and he snores like an old man. Until we reach Regent's Park. He can't see out. He'd have no way of knowing visually anything's different. But he can smell it, and he recognizes that smell. And the closer we get to the house, the more animated he is. And he's howling and making noises like a teenage boy who's grounded, ready to get out of the cage. He knows home. Saints, you know home when you see this in God's people. The third one, it's a tribal banner. It's a logo. It symbolically proclaims this is who we are. This is who we are to other Christians, and it's who we are to the world. Now look, having lived in 4 nations and 16 cities, having experienced a lot of crazy life, each one of those times had me looking for where are the people of God who are my tribe. I'll tell you straight up. I could care less the instrument. Could care less if the song was written yesterday or 1,800 years ago. Could care less. As long as the words aren't heresy or self-centered and they're praising God, I can groove with ancient Latin or Christian hip-hop. Because I recognize the tribal logo. I could care whether they have vestments or no vestments, whether they meet in a building that is ancient and architecture proclaims the transcendence of God, or you're meeting in a park. I look for the tribal banner of who they are. The difference between Jesus, son of Sirach, and Jesus of Nazareth is the upside downness of God's kingdom. The upside downness, because these people are completely oriented at self-giving. Don't think so? Read the next verses. Be salt, be light, be wise, and build your house, build your life on rock. Don't be fooled by things that look firm and aren't. Now, why is poor in spirit the first one? Poor in spirit doesn't mean what you think. Poor in spirit does not mean that you're sad and dour. It doesn't mean that you're one of those serious Christians. Anybody who communicates with me, the friends of mine that communicate with me on social media, know that I'm constantly sharing quite satirical, often comique noir humor. I love when you share the service with a child and an animal. Last service, I had 3 phones go off in the service, so we do have an improvement. Being poor in spirit isn't being serious and sad. Being poor in spirit, I've met Christians who are passionate for something in the kingdom, let's say social justice, but they're so serious, they're angry, and they're angry at every other Christian for not being about what they're about. That's not poor in spirit. That's an arrogance of pulling yourself up by your bootstraps and having a right to stand before God. Let me flip it upside down. Poor in spirit is knowing who you are and who you aren't. Poor in spirit is being self-defined and not anxious. Poor in spirit means this is who God's made me, this is who He's not made me, and I'm good with my contribution. And I'm going to will myself to be conformed to Jesus' image, how He relates with me. Because the way He relates with me is different than Sheila or Rita or Sue or Mark or Miriam. Because we're all different people with different gifts in the body and the kingdom. And you actually are content to go where God wants to take you. Being poor in spirit is when you recognize an upside-down value from Western civilization and Kiwi society is that, yeah, pulling yourself up by your bootstraps is good, but that's not what makes you look like Jesus. That list of photographs that I shared with you, all those people, it's admirable. And they all pulled themselves. I don't know if you've seen Dame Valerie's movie about her life, a biography of her life. I went in there. I'm going to tell you, my wife dragged it to me. I went in there expecting a 2 out of 10. I'm a pretty hard customer. I walked out and went, wow. She epitomizes the humility of pulling yourself up by the bootstraps and continuing to going even when others pushed you down. But the poor in spirit in the kingdom, this upside down values, recognizes I'm only in the kingdom because Jesus came and found me while I was yet a sinner. And I know that I still sin. I've shared with you before Sir Ian Thomas's words to me, and he even wrote a book about it. You have been saved, you are being saved, you will be saved. It's recognizing that I am so far from perfect and blow it, and my gifts aren't perfect, and I never deliver the perfect sermon. I always sit down and go, I wish I had a tough situation where I've blown it and been impatient, but it's Jesus in me, not me in Jesus, that is the difference. I recognize my need, and I recognize that all the gifts and contributions I make aren't mine, but they're His, and what a glorious, fun, lovely honor to get to dance with God. Poor in spirit gives credit where the credit is due. And if you think poor in spirit is a lie, that you're worthless or pitiful, and you don't have anything to offer, and you don't do what Michael and John does, or you don't have the extroverted confidence of some of the other people in our church or another church, then you're wrong. That's not poor in spirit. Scripture tells you that, you'll know this metaphor, you literally are the apple of His eye. This morning, it's dawn, the sun is up, And they're building 8 developments around Regent's Park. It's crazy. I hate it. My pukeko crops are going to go away. And they've got the road on one of those controlled one lane with the little traffic light thingies and the orange cones everywhere. And I pulled up to it, and I'm reflecting on this. I know it sounds godly. No, it was fear of coming back after all these weeks. And all of a sudden, like 200 little sparrows land. And they're literally on the road, and they're on the side of the road, and they're on all of this really long grass, and they're just pecking, and they're all excited and happy. And I'm reminded, He feeds them, and He cares a lot more about you. You're worth so much more. So poor in spirit people can't help but care about others. They realize that they were starving, and they found bread. They realized they were parched and they had found water, and they want everybody else to experience that. Watch a teenager discover a new band and want to share it with everybody, including granddad. Good luck. Poor in spirit has an empathy to the point of action where God leads them to be a beautiful attitude, the fragrance of Christ, the salt that savors, to be the light, to be a royal nation of priests, to help a world that doesn't know him, know him. So a few of the poor that someone poor in spirit cares about, sure, the economically poor, but the poor in heart, you know what I mean by that, and the poor in mind. You know what I mean by that. The poor in relationship and the lonely and the dysfunctional due to a life of wounds and hurts and dysfunctions, sometime due to nothing they've done, and sometime as you get twisted up, you start self-fulfilling prophecies. The poor spiritually, who've been spiritually abused and told they had to perform religiously. The poor in spirit care about those are in the poverty of persecution, be it our sisters and brothers in horrible places, or people who pay for it because friends or family make fun of them or deride them or ostracize them, and all of a sudden they don't feel part of their family's tribe anymore. Or they get passed over work because they don't partake in things that the rest of the work office participates in. The poor spiritually who are longing for an alive church. In those 16 cities, I went to one city, I won't tell you which, Texas. 3 years, I didn't see one map, one tribal banner that smelled like Jesus. I spent 3 years virtually alone. Sure, there were churches everywhere. But they were doing church, and there were reasons they were the way they were. Every church has a story. God knows we have one. We're not throwing rocks at anybody. We live in a glass house. But those who are poor in spirit because they can't find tribe. John Newton, who was a slave ship captain, who had been the son of a slave ship captain, who had contributed to and been part of and been a significant cause for the death of thousands of slaves, because on one of those slave ships, stacked like cordwood, in horrible, rancid, ungodly conditions, they'd lose half of their cargo. And he came to faith, and after a noted season of remorse and repentance and humility, God took him and lifted him up, and he had a poor in spirit that could not have kept him in that self-flagellating state of life, but he moved to grace, and he could not help but share it. And he wrote in Olney with another fellow hundreds of hymns. Half of them are still sung today, and one that every last person in this room has sung, Amazing Grace. When you understand who wrote it in his life, that song takes on a whole new meaning. He went on to be called to be a priest, and his last assignment was this little church in the financial district of London, which was the largest, strongest, longest-lasting empire in the world. And he's in the shadow of power, being poor in spirit. He went on. His greatest contribution wasn't from the pulpit. His greatest contribution was the fruit of his ministry, which you'll know the name, particularly when you think of John's sin regarding slavery. He became the spiritual direction supervisor, mentor, discipler, anam cara, for William Wilberforce to end slavery in the empire. Mostly people who are poor in spirit look and smell like Jesus because it's a result of having been in his presence. You know when you've met one of those people who remained in the tent and have been in seeking God's presence for a long time. They're just different. Even without saying anything spiritual, they're different. Because it's not a program, it's a process. It's a full surrender and allowing the Spirit to move in and through and with you. And there's something that's different, and they begin to look and smell like Jesus. I watched my father-in-law, who's now 80 today. And his love and recognition and this very introverted man. And you look at his kids and the grandkids, and you go, legacy. That legacy began before him and was handed to him, and he's handed it down. And he sits and he notices those in the room that nobody else notices. And he reads the situation like a hawk. You see, if a Jesus person who is known under that tribal banner, who is known because you look for home for those signs on the map, who has forged those beautiful attitudes, you look like Jesus. And this song, which is 2,000 years old, a poem, Philippians 2, verses 5 to 11. Having this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not account equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of people. He did not hold on to and grasp the rightful trappings of being God and King, but became poor in spirit for the sake of others. And being found poor in spirit in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. If you want to be poor in spirit, you hang out in God's presence. Even when you don't know what to say and you don't have words of what he's saying to you, you will be changed. And the values of this world become foreign. They don't resonate with you any longer. A person who's poor in spirit will shed over time. Let me go to that cool slide. Can you advance it one day? It's stuck? There we go. Thank you. Will shed the need for security. Will no longer identify with a priority of comfort. Look, I've stayed a lot of places, including sleeping on the ground in horrible places to literally beds in Her Majesty's castle. But the more you follow Jesus and get upside down, the less it matters. You receive what God gives you with peace and contentment. The less you strive and grope consciously and unconsciously for control, the less you need to be seen having influence, the less you care garnering prestige, the less you are hung up on beauty. We live in a society obsessed with beauty. You stop seeking wealth, and it just doesn't matter as much anymore. Let me tell you, nobody likes being poor. Poor people, and I would love when the Northeast Coast people would come down to New Orleans, the young ones, and they would want to help the poor black people after Katrina. And they would give them vegetarian meals. And they would say, you know, hey, we shared this with you because it's cheap and you can learn how to do it. And the black people, first thing out of their mouth would be like, where's the meat? Well, meat's expensive and you don't have a lot of money. Yeah, but that's because we don't have a lot of money. If we had the money, we'd have meat. And you have money, so where's the meat? So we start sharing more graciously and radically. And that looks different in every single life because every single person is different. You stop striving after ability. That doesn't mean you won't make great contributions, you won't be credible, but that's not how you define and value yourself or others. You stop seeking status and station and titles. That's a hard one. That's a hard one because everybody wants to progress and make their ultimate contribution. And God may lift you up, or he may lift you up later. Go read about Joseph in Genesis. You see, the poor in spirit identify themselves with that upside-down kingdom to be like Jesus. So what do you do with this? We've got 9 weeks in the Beatitudes. You're gonna hear that passage a lot. Maybe you read it every single day. Like, really read it. Don't read it to read through it and be over it. You know, don't listen to it the way you listen to the readings in a service. But get quiet and get still so that you can hear and read them every day or several times a week. Don't make it a rule, because then you'll start beating yourself up because you're not religious enough. But maybe you just print it off and have it there in front of you. Have it in your car. Have it on the shower wall in a Ziploc bag. And you celebrate and rejoice where God is moving, and you just ask God without expecting the question immediately, God, how do I open my will so that I begin to look like the beautiful attitudes in the roadmap and the tribal banner that others will recognize home and follow? Maybe you read the rest of the Sermon on the Mount very often to say this opens the opus, and then the other movements of the opus play those out. Maybe you look for ways to abandon the values of a society of us or me or being better than everybody else. And you know what's funny is that the most insecure are the ones who are concerned the most about those titles and status. Dare I say, whether the All Blacks win or lose. Our identity is wrapped up in temporal, meaningless things. But I want to close with two things. The first being, I want to give you a moment just to be silent. And you choose, you will, to open your will and invite the Spirit to speak to you. And if you are able to open your will, some won't be there yet, you ask God to speak what he wants to do with you in his presence, seeking his presence, in and through and with and for as a gift, you. So that maybe this church, individually and collectively as a body, we become to smell and look and taste and look for others who need to just taste and experience. You notice I didn't say deliver a DVD drive's worth of theology. You simply be those people that they recognize are different. Let's take a moment and listen. Lord God, King of the universe, Adonai, Lord of lords, King of kings, Jesus, our brother. Come speak to us, your servants, and listen. Now, the second thing. I don't shy away from talking about it because we need to destigmatize it. Because when you don't talk about it, you do stigmatize it, and you actually never process and heal from it. This church went from a church to a church that had a lot of pain. Earthquakes didn't help, and mosque shootings didn't help, and 2018 didn't help. And then COVID certainly didn't help. There are seasons in a church's life, and it's now 2023. And while COVID's not gone, its grip on our fear and our anxiety is waning. And it's a new season and a new time. And what I have sensed in my time of way, in a lot of time trying to live out what I'm saying to you, because I've been thinking about it for weeks, is it's 2023, and the two of us praying and thinking and talking together, it's time. It's 2023, and it's time. It's time to automatically reverting to fatigue and defensiveness and putting up the personal walls and shields. It's time for the wounds and the angers, some of them quite justified, to be put down. It's time for this church to embrace these beatitudes and again be these people. It's time. I love the scene of Jesus at the Pool of Bethesda, a pagan pool there in Jerusalem, first built by the Greeks and then expanded by the Romans and then expanded by Herod. Palatial pools. And Jesus finds a fellow who's been there for decades waiting for healing with the bubbling waters of the geyser seismic type activity that we would be familiar with. And Jesus sees all of these people, but he goes to this one. And he asks him one question. Do you really want to be healed? Not do you want to be healed or what do you want me to do for you? Do you really want to be healed? So sisters, brothers, in this service, a couple of mother fathers, not a lot. Sons and daughters. It's time to answer that question. Do you individually or do you as a people want to be healed, or do we just want to continue to live our lives limping or with a walker or in a wheelchair the rest of our lives? Do we as a church just want to survive the painful decade it went through, or do you want to walk and jump and leap? If John or Graham get to heaven and they can't leap and run like a deer, if Gail can't hear like a hawk, they're going to be some upset people. There are theologians that are teaching that, no, God made you that way. You're not handicapped. Society's handicapped you. John, don't say what came out of your mouth when we've talked about this. Because if that is okay, and it's only society that handicapped them, Jesus spent a lot of time demonstrating he's God by dealing with eyes and ears and mouth and souls and legs and arms and bleeding and a host of other things. And if that isn't true, that God wants us to be healed and healthy and producing fruit, think of what I do with roses and fruit trees that don't perform. If we don't believe that's God's intent, then we are calling him a liar, because in Scripture he says in Revelation, I am going to make everything new. This week we lost one of our saints, long-term member here, Victor Holder. Victor flew, not this Victor, he's still alive, praise God, came through the surgeries. But Victor Holder was a pilot in the Battle of London in World War II. A lovely saint who had a real transformation in a Baptist church here in Christchurch in the 60s. Of course, he grew up with some measure of faith, but it was that limited religiousness. And he was this lovely guy who was well past the age of changing the world and earning a KBE. But this old guy, by doing nothing, impacted me. And if you go in my office, you will see two pictures of this strapping young lad with all the vigor and youth and pride of that time. And there's a picture of me and him together today. Because of the beautiful attitudes and the roadmap and the banner that he has tried. And he's home now, and he's well, and he's healed, and he's no longer broken in body, losing thoughts and memories. He's full and whole. But as a people and as a church, though we live in a broken world with limitations, it's not God's intent for you to remain that way as a human being, individually or as a church or as a people. God doesn't want you giving money or coming to church because you're giving tribute like you would to a king. He wants you to come be with him and seek his presence and be transformed and become like him and watch the fruit that he produces through you. Now, that's a choice of will. And this is a hard slam on the brake, cut off the stereo ending to a sermon. But it actually is just a choice because that's what God wants to do in us. And it's this year, or like most churches that have been through this level of pain, you never really recover. You continue to use a walker the rest of your life. And is that really what we want? In the next 9 weeks, in this new year, may we seek his face and his presence and listen with a will that's open and says, God, conform me to your image because I don't know how. But speak and work and move. I'm listening and I want to go and I want to be like, name your spiritual giant. Thanks.
Almighty God, we ask you to hear our prayers today for the church, the world, our local community, and people in particular need. Almighty God, we pray for the Christian church throughout the world. We pray for Christians who are persecuted because of their faith, and ask for your blessing on organizations such as Open Door who support them. We ask for your blessing on all clergy in our diocese. Bless Michael and John as they lead us, along with our associate ministers, staff, and the vestry. We ask you to strengthen and guide them as they lead us. Bless the holiday program this week. Keep them safe as they travel on outings. Strengthen and guide the leaders as they bring your love and joy to the children attending. We pray for our parish of St. Christopher's as we come together again after a holiday break. We pray that you'll show each one of us what role you want us to play in serving our church family and the local community here at Avonhead. In a moment of silence, please pray for any aspect of parish life which is particularly on your mind today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we pray for the nations of the world and their leaders. We pray for all nations that continue to be torn apart by war, poverty, and illness, and for all the organizations that try to help the people living in those countries. In a moment of silence, please pray for any country that is on your mind today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we pray for New Zealand's political leadership. We especially bring to you the decisions being made about a new Prime Minister today. We thank you that we live in a stable democratic country where these decisions are made peacefully. We know that you establish and have authority over governments according to your will and purpose. We ask for your hand to be present and guide our government to make good decisions for the good of all people in New Zealand. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we know that there are many people who are struggling due to illness, financial problems, loneliness, or loss of loved ones. We bring to you the Norris family, those named on our pew sheet, and others known to us. In a moment of silence, please pray for one person that you know in particular, who is in particular need of God's help today. Merciful God, we ask you to draw close to all of those mentioned so that they may be aware of your healing presence and to provide your peace and comfort for them at this time. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, help us to be your fruit to others and to bless others. Strengthen our faith so that your presence may be seen clearly in all that we do and say each day throughout the coming week. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand as we sing together our offertory song, Only by Grace Can We Enter.
Only by grace can we enter, only by grace can we stand, not by our human endeavor, but by the blood of the Lamb. Into your presence you call us, you call us to come. Into your presence you draw us, and now by your grace we come. Now by Lord, if you mock our transgressions, who would stand? Thanks to your grace, we are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Lord, if you mock our transgressions, who would stand? Thanks to your grace, we are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Only by grace can we enter, only by grace can we stand, not by our human endeavor, but by the blood of the Lamb. Into your presence you call us, you call us to come. Into your presence you draw us, and now by your grace we come. Lord, if you mock our transgressions, who would stand? Thanks to your grace we are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Lord, if you mock our transgressions, who would stand? Thanks to your grace, we are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Only by grace can we enter, only by grace can we stand, not by our human endeavor, but but by the blood of the Lamb. Into your presence you call us, you call us to come. Into your presence you draw us, and now by your grace we come. Now by your grace we come. Now by your grace we come.
To you, Lord, belongs the greatness and the glory and the victory and the majesty. All that is in the heavens and the earth is yours, and of your own we give you. Rise and shine, dear sheeple, the Lord is here.
God's Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right indeed, Holy Lord, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise through your Christ, your only Son. You are the source of life for all creation, and you formed us in your own image. Male and female, you created us. When we sinned and turned away, you called us back to yourself and gave your Son to be our Savior. By his death on the cross, he made the one perfect sacrifice for the sin of the world and freed us from the bondage of sin. You raised him to life in triumph and exalted him in glory. Through him you send your Holy Spirit upon your church and make us your people. And so we proclaim your glory as we say, Tapu, tapu, he tapu te ariki, te atua o te mana me te kaha, ki tonu te rangi me te whenua e tō kororia. Ohana e runga rawa. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Well, glory and thanksgiving to you, Almighty Father, because on the night before he died, your Son, Jesus Christ, took bread. When he had given you thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me. After supper, he took the cup. When he had given you thanks, he gave it to them and said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you. Do this as often as you drink it to remember me. For loving God, recalling Christ's death and resurrection, we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, which we offer through Christ, our great high priest. Send your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine which we receive may be to us the body and blood of Christ, and that we, filled with the Spirit's grace and power, may be renewed for the service of your kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Your death we show forth, your resurrection we proclaim, your coming we await. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share the one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, Jesus, bearer of our sins, Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. Draw near and receive the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. In remembrance that he died for us, let us feed on him in our hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, Holy Spirit,
Almighty God, giver of all good things, we thank you for feeding us with the precious food of the body and blood of our Saviour Jesus Christ. We thank you for your love and care and assuring us of your kindness to us and uniting us in the blessed fellowship of all faithful people. Therefore, ever-living God, keep us steadfast in your holy fellowship. And now we offer ourselves all that we have and are to serve you faithfully in the world through Jesus, our Redeemer, to whom with you and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Amen. May God Almighty bless you. May He keep you. May He wake you up to your poverty and detach you from easy answers and from anesthetics. May he chase you with his goodness and teach you where true joy and true riches are to be found, in justice, in mercy, in faithfulness, and in simplicity. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.
To work on my ADHD and OCD. Quick notes for you. This week, if you would give yourself even reminders in your phone to be praying for the team led by Miriam and Jack as they lead the holiday program and the first one without Sarah around at the helm. They're ready. They've got it. They're shaking in their boots. That means God's in charge. It's going to be a great week, though. They've got a lot of kids, and I ask that you would seriously be praying for God to work. We don't want to be a community center. We want to be a place where people experience those blessings. Okay? In regards to holiday program, these young adults and teens that are going to be leading this thing have put in a ton of hours already. And they'll be here tonight setting up, what time? 6 to 7. Miriam's a little panicked because most of her team is still off on holiday, coming back tonight, et cetera, et cetera. So anybody who wants to come in and lend half an hour hand with Miriam for setup should be grateful. But mostly on Friday, after they've done 11-hour days, and they're tired come Friday, and we have a great tradition that our whole church leans in on Friday afternoon, and in 20 minutes everything's put away and ready for the weekend. And so if you would be willing to come in and give a hand on Friday from about 3:15 to 3:45, if you'd let Jack and Miriam know, they would be really grateful for that and for your help. February 12th and 26th, so two weekends, several weeks out yet, but we're going to do our annual February barbecue. And those who go, oh, but it's always burgers. Well, this year we've got sausages, so it's a true Kiwi Barbie. And we also have ham on a leg of ham that is to be cut. I will cut it, and I like generous cuttings. So you'll have some options there. So I invite you to come along and participate after this service on the 12th and on the 26th. Now, the 26th, we're having a shared worship and a shared lunch with Bishop Peter here, and with seven people being confirmed. Six of them are young adults. One of them is an adult. But that's not new. We've had that before. And this response to God, I invite you to also be praying this next month for those who are going to be confirmed as they finish that covenant with the church and with God that they are tribe with us. And it's going to be a great fun. We only get the bishop about once a year. I have to queue it up months in advance. But he'll be with us on the 26th of February, which will be lovely. Sharing the pulpit with a child or a pet. It's a crazy thing. Working on my OCD. But if you, again, for those who've been tuned out watching a small child, the 26th of February, shared worship and lunch and confirmation. Now, John jumped in the first service because I didn't say it. If the Spirit is pressing on you, I've been baptized, so the church and God have made covenant with me, and it's time for me to make covenant with God and his church that I'm a part of that tribe. And, oh, I know it's so hard, isn't it, sweetheart? Oh, you got told. And you would like to consider the scary step of confirmation, as scary as that is in our context. If you would have a chat with John or I, sooner than later would be great. But it would, we're very willing to broaden that group of seven. And I think that's it. I'll close with this, and we will have our recessional and go home and enjoy summer. You know, all the stuff I talked about, I didn't have time to talk about the payoff. So go back to Matthew 5, 1 to 11, and read the payoff. These people who are this way, here's the reward. It's not always instant, but it often is quite dramatic. The poor in spirit will inherit heaven. Amazing. So remember that. Have a great week.
Any celebrations?
I understand, sweetheart.
Any birthdays, anniversaries, new jobs, driver's license, sports achievements, etc. Cam.
Hi. I got a new job. So 2 to 3 weeks from now, waiting for start date, I'll be working for Spark as a 101 operator / AMS operator person.
Very nice. Thank you.
So Angus and I did a leadership program called Ryla throughout the week. It was incredible. There was around 40 participants, 40 participants our age, and they all voted who they wanted to send to the Aspiring Leaders Forum in Wellington. They could only pick one. They voted to send Angus, and I was runner-up. They named me Queen of Ryla 2023, I think because I was so awkward and loving it. And so, yeah, that's all stuff to celebrate.
It was our 14th wedding anniversary this week.
Next week is my mom's and dad's 37th wedding anniversary. Thank you. Oh, I already take one. I'll only one. Do you want one more? Just one, maybe.
We thank you that we have occasions, happy occasions to mark. So we thank you for new job. We thank you for wedding anniversaries. We thank you for recognition of young people and their leadership abilities. And we thank you too that we can celebrate another holiday program coming. So we do want to pray especially for that now. And we thank you for the many ways you are amongst us. And we thank you for your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's stand and sing together our closing hymn, Rousingly, Because It Is Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. Springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by and the peace that endureth, thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning.
now to love and serve the Lord. Go in peace. Please join us in the hall for a time of fellowship.